press the bell icon on the YouTube app to never miss a video from News Laundry.
What makes a democracy work?
Matadan.
Bhagwan.
Subsidy.
Opportunity.
Balidan.
Samman.
Azadi.
Gustakhi.
Gau Mata.
Mera Khata.
Revolution.
Evolution.
Fusion.
Constitution.
Hello, I'm Meghnad and you're watching Constitution, where we wonder out loud, kya aapki democracy reserved hai? Yes, you heard that right. Today, we are going to talk about that thing, depending on your surname and the state you're from, you were either for or against it. But now that there is 10% reservation for people from economically weaker sections, enabled by the world's favorite PM, it has forced you to relook at the merit argument that your uncle has been sending you on WhatsApp and going on and on about it for the last 20 years. Because reservation is suddenly fair? I mean, I'm as confused as you are. Hey, who changed the script for reservation debate, by the way? I didn't. Hopefully, we'll be able to give you some answers today though. What is reservation? Why does it exist? Who needs it? When is it needed? Will it ever go away? Will I give you any answers? Will the answers be to your satisfaction? Well, as far as the last question is concerned, only you can answer that. Reservation is and remains one of the most contentious issues in our country. At any given point of time, there are at least half a dozen groups demanding reservations in government jobs and colleges in India. Be they the dominant Jats of Haryana, powerful Patidars of Gujarat, or influential Marathas of Maharashtra. You know, disadvantaged and backward communities. Here's the thing. In India, there is always someone who wants reservation. And inevitably, there is always someone who scorns the group for wanting it. Unless they are the people who get it. Reservations exist mostly because we are not really a very polite country. I mean, we may be a country of lovely individuals, but as a society and a group, we are far too prone to caste violence and the occasional casual lynching. Here's how we promote tolerance in India.
Maulana, bait! Bait aur sun! Kitna bhi chillayega, mandir wahi banega!
Vikas par baat kijiye, aapko sab jante hain. आप किसके बेटे हैं आपको सब जानते हैं
राम के लिए कुछ मत कहना
गद्दार बाबर बाबर पाकिस्तान जाके देख एक बार क्या करेगा पाकिस्तान तुम्हारा
हिंदुस्तान का खाती है शबनम लोन पाकिस्तान का गाती है
नेशनलिस्ट नाउडेज आर लाइक ए बोल इंडिया टॉलरेंट है नहीं तो देख लूंगा तुझे मैं कास्ट वायलेंस रिलीजियस पर्सिक्यूशन व्हाट नॉनसेंस गो टू पाकिस्तान इफ यू थिंक इंडिया इज नॉट टॉलरेंट वी डोंट टॉलरेट सच टॉक Tolerant Bharat ki tolerant jai. Hashtag much tolerance. Hashtag very nuance. Hashtag such love. Okay, so GD Bakshi antics aside, simply put, reservations exist to correct historical injustices. Over thousands of years, there have been certain groups of people that have been kept starved of power, education, resources, opportunities, access to facilities, and even food. That's a fact. Now, after 1,000 years, if you come to me and say, oh, we've abolished the caste system, untouchability, manual scavenging, it's all gone. Yay, level playing field. Basically, if you believe this, then I'll tell you unapologetically, you are wrong. No matter how wonderful your speech, how sweeping your rhetoric, how big your chest, it is not a level playing field. The main purpose of reservation is to fight the scourge of untouchability and to fight against the idea that some people are born impure and that some groups of people are inferior while others are superior. Here's a truth bomb for you. Reservation is not unique to India. Yeah, that's true. In other countries, it's called affirmative action, and it is found in some way, shape or form in countries across the world, from the USA, UK and the former Yugoslavia to Latin American countries such as Bolivia, Brazil, Peru and some African countries like Nigeria and South Africa. So basically, it's something the governments have been forced to deal with across the world when they have a diverse population and when they have large sections of their populations that have been traditionally marginalized. Affirmative action happens when the country in question feels, wait, why is there a group of people that is not being treated right by the rest of the population? That's not right. The only way India is different is that unlike many other countries, India does not have reservation in the private sector. We only have it in our public sector. Does that make it better or worse? Should my uncle complain or not? Does he like America or doesn't he? One thing I know for sure, many WhatsApp uncles want it gone regardless of how it is applied or for whom. Merit hona! Yeah. Let's get down to some constitution-based education instead. Our constitution provides reservation for only three social classes, that is scheduled caste, scheduled tribes, socially and educationally backward classes. Oh, wait, now they have added a fourth class by amending the constitution rapidly in 48 hours. Economically weaker sections, popularly known as mostly general category Indians who are jealous of the other three classes? Yeah, so this happened.
Samjha asa gruhit dharla ki arakshan mial tar nokrias nahi hai. Karan aata bankanmadhe halu-halu electronic IT alyamule nokrya kami hoon ralya. Sarkarmadhe bharti band hai. Tyamule shikshanat arakshanacha fayda scholarship fee milla. Kiwa पण नोकऱ्या कुठे आहे त्यामुळे आरक्षणाचा झगडा असा आहे की बॅकवर्डनेस बिकमिंग ए पॉलिटिकल इंटरेस्ट.
मराठी माणूस जागा झाला रे. लेट्स गेट वन थिंग स्ट्रेट, रिझर्वेशन इज नॉट अ चॅरिटी दॅट इज रोल्ड आउट बाय द स्टेट बट अन इंट्रिन्सिक पार्ट ऑफ स्टेट पॉलिसी टू एन्श्युअर दॅट दोज इन वीकर अँड ट्रेडिशनली मार्जिनलाइज्ड सेक्शन्स ऑफ द इंडियन सोसायटी गेट देअर फेअर शेअर. It's about providing social justice. It is not about providing jobs, nor is it an employment guarantee scheme. I mean, if it were, it would be a terrible employment guarantee scheme. I mean, how many government jobs are there? Those that don't qualify for reservation can hardly complain because the number of posts that can be filled up by reservation if properly and fully implemented is a mere 0.25%. of the total jobs available in the economy. Yes. Let's do some back of the envelope calculations today. 92% of our jobs in our country are in the informal sector where there is no reservation. The remaining 8% are in the formal sector jobs, including 5% in the private sector where there is no reservation either, which leaves only 3% jobs in the government sector. Of this 3%, 2% is promotions, while 1%, the remaining 1%, is through direct recruitment. Wait, there's more. Of that 1% of the jobs to which reservations applies, only half, that is 0.5% of the jobs are actually reserved. Out of the 0.5% reserved jobs, only half get filled. And essentially, we are going gaga for 0.25% jobs in the whole of Indian economy. See, this is what epic research looks like. Yeah. 0.25%. That's less than 12 lakh jobs in a country where around 50 crore people are in the workforce. Now do you get why we are saying that reservation is not a job thing? It is not solely for the economically backward. And I know that some of you are still undeterred and will say undeserving people get jobs because merit hona chahiye. So when did reservation start? Was it because of that prime minister of ours that spent so much time abroad? No, not him. It's not always him. Yeah, it might be him though. No, it's actually not him either. In fact, it was not cynical parliamentarians running after vote banks who first introduced the concept of reservations. For that, we have to thank our princely states of the South. Wait, what? Huh? I did not know this. Wait, just let me check WhatsApp University once. No, nothing here, no. Does not mention. Wait, let me check Twitter once. No, I mean nothing, damn it. Might as well consult a history book for this, I guess. Tamil Nadu has flirted with the idea of quotas as far back as 1831. Okay, so I'm going to get so much hate from my own righteous family right now, but guys, bear with me. As the movements against Brahmin domination gained momentum in the early 20th century, in 1921, under the Justice Party, there was reservation for backward castes and even Dalits in the erstwhile Madras. Guys, that is what it was called back then. I'm not being racist. And people who lived in Madras were called?
Madrasis.
Sheesh, kya disgusting aadmi ho tum. Okay, anyway. As a response to the social movements, there were attempts to remove imbalances in governance through reservation by the Maharajas of Kolhapur in 1902, Mysore 1921, Travancore 1935 and Cochin. North India, tumhara tab kya chalu tha vaise? The pushback towards caste correction was led by people like Guru Ravidas, Jyotirao Phule and Periyar. It was taken to another level by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. You know, the guy that our Lord Commander loves.
Agar Baba Sahab Ambedkar na hote, to main yahan tak nahi pahunch
paata. During the Constituent Assembly debates, Baba Sahab Ambedkar knew well that unless reservations in jobs and legislature was given to the Dalits, they would never be in a position to be equal partners in the administration of the country, and they will remain oppressed and slaves forever. Our Constituent Assembly was divided on the matter of reservation policy. While Sardar Patel and a few others opposed the reservation to minority communities, except Anglo-Indians, Ambedkar defended the policy of reservation. He believed, following the examples in some of the larger princely states, that representation in governance was the only way to end the scourge of untouchability. So, basically, what we are saying is that reservation is not about economics or jobs, it is about justice. It has always been about justice. It is about rectifying thousands of years of social wrongs for justice reasons. But why is reservation such a hot issue even after 70 years? It's because governments over decades have failed to create an environment which is conducive to job growth. So much so that so many people still believe that getting a government job is the only road to salvation. To lakhs of Indians, reservation is either a hindrance or the only opportunity for economic security. And with the coming of Mandal Commission, which expanded the base of reservations by bringing OBCs into the picture, the larger conversations around social justice got intrinsically linked with reservation. So much so that we live in a time where reservations are seen as the only way to get social justice. But even that is not true. Reservation is only one way. Education, non-discrimination in the workplace and in governance, strict enforcement of existing laws, progressive taxation, strong community and forest rights are also all some of the many ways in which social justice can be achieved. And if you are one of those people who looks and says, what caste discrimination? We are in 2019. Except for politicians, nobody talks about caste. In fact, we shouldn't talk about caste because it is not there. Well, don't get your janeus in a tangle because you're wrong. Just take a look at what happens when a backward caste and a forward caste tries to marry. Or how even today, in villages in India, people of a certain caste are denied basic services or even access to water from communal wells. And I know those are just extreme examples. Debates around reservations have vaise bhi lost all nuance. Merit without understanding privilege is a hollow argument. We are trying to achieve a meritorious society. If you want to get rid of reservations, get rid of privilege first. Because some get meritorious because of caste privilege, while some get it through reservations. So only those who have privilege would frame the issue of merit versus reservation rather than privilege versus reservation. And if you're someone who thinks this only happens in villages and not in urban India, you need to look at some matrimonial ads.
Does patriarchy have a religion? If it does, I ask, patriarchy comes in the form of triple talaq being imposed on women. What patriarchy do you want to call that? Would Jack Dorsey, Would Jack Dorsey hold a poster saying, "Stop Islamic patriarchy"? If the employees and the senior management of Twitter in India is anti-Hindu, they should say so. I say repeatedly, someone insults all Muslims, all Christians and all Parsis, block them. I say today, you use this dirty language on a social media platform and you get a verified handle.
These champions of social justice were standing there and participating in that kind of hate mongering. Not even for once it occurred to them that they are basically participating in hate against a small minority of India. My grandfather was a Brahmin. He died exploited by Thakurs in his village as a landless laborer. Do you know that? Today, a poor Brahmin is exploited as much as a poor Dalit. Do you know that Dalits who become SPs and DIGs and who go to police, the first thing they go and beat up Brahmins? What about reverse discrimination?
You saw that? Now, that is a flawed debate. It's not merit versus reservation. It's privilege versus reservation. And you and I and our families are all culpable in some way, shape or form. When your casteist uncles send ridiculous forwards about the non-existence of caste, we must call out their bigotry instead of turning a blind eye to their casual casteism and demand that they understand the issue first. Maybe just make them watch this episode of Constitution at least. Yeah, this has been Meghnad and you have been watching Constitution. Remember, policy isn't funny, but the Janeudharis definitely are.